She was banished. What could she have done to have deserved so terrible a punishment?
Something awful. She married a mortal.
Is it injudicious to marry a mortal?
Injudicious? It strikes at the very heart of fairy lore. The fairy, by our laws, the fairy who marries a mortal dies.
But Iolanthe didn't die.
No! Because your queen, who loved her with a surpassing love, commuted her sentence to penal servitude for life on condition that she left her husband and never communicated with him again.
That sentence of penal servitude she is now working out at the bottom of that stream on her head.
Yes, but when I banished her, I'm sure I gave her all the pleasant places on earth to dwell in. I never intended that she should go live at the bottom of a stream. Why? It makes me perfectly wretched to think of the discomfort she must have undergone.
And think of the damp. Her chest was always delicate.
And the frogs. I shall never have a moment's peace until I know why Iolanthe went to live with the frogs.
Then why not summon her and ask her?
Why? Because if I set eyes on her, I should forgive her.
Then why not forgive her? 25 years. It's a long time. Think how we loved her.
Loved her? What was your love to mine? She was invaluable to me. You taught me to curl inside a buttercup, Iolanthe. Who taught me to swing upon a cobweb, Iolanthe. Who taught me to dive into a dewdrop, to nestle in a nutshell, to gamble on gossamer, Iolanthe.
She certainly did surprising things. Oh, give her back to us, Great Queen, for your sake, if not for ours.
I should be strong, but I am weak. I should be marble, but I am clay. Oh, her punishment has been heavier than I intended. I didn't mean that she should go and live among the frogs. But well, well, it shall be as you wish. It shall be as you wish.
Come to our call, come.
places on earth, Dwelly. Why on earth did you go and choose to live at the bottom of that stream?
To be near my son, Strephon.
Bless my heart! I didn't know you had a son.
He was born soon after I left my husband, by your royal command. But he does not even know of his father's existence.
How old is he?
24.
24? Lord, look at you and think that you had a son of 24. That is the advantage of being immortal. We never grow old. Isn't he pretty?
He's extremely pretty. But he's rather fond of Bakewell pudding.
Oh, I see no objection to Bakewell pudding. In moderation.
And what is he? He's an Arcadian shepherd, and he loves Phyllis, a warden chancery.
A mere shepherd? And he half a fairy?
He's a fairy down to the waist, but his legs are mortal.
Dear me.
I must confess, I am not more curious than other people, but I should like to see a person who is a fairy down to the waist, but whose legs are mortal.
Nothing easier, for here he comes.
Good morrow, good mother. Good mother, good morrow. By some means or other, still purchase or borrow some means of concealing the joy you are feeling. So joy in a measure expressive of pleasure. For I'm to be married today, today. Yes, I'm to be married today.
Yes, he's to be married.
Not he, indeed. To all my tearful prayers, he answers me, "A shepherd lad is no fit helpmate for a ward of chancery." I stood in court, and there I sung him songs of Arcady, with flageolet accompaniment, in vain. At first he seemed amused, so did the bar, but quickly wearying of my song and pipe, bade me get out. The servile usher then, crumpled bands and rusted bombazine, led me, still singing, into Chancery Lane. I'll go no more. I'll marry her today, and brave the upshot, be it what it may. But who are these?
Oh, Strephon, rejoice with me. My queen has pardoned me.
Pardoned you, mother? This is good news indeed.
And these are my beloved sisters.
Your sisters? Then they are my aunts.
A pleasant piece of news for your bride on her wedding day.
Hush. My bride knows nothing of my fairyhood. I dare not tell her, lest it frighten her. She thinks me mortal and prefers me so.
Your fairyhood doesn't seem to have done you much
good. Much good? My dear aunt, it's the curse of my existence. What's the good of being half a fairy? My upper half can creep through a keyhole. But what's the good of that when my legs are left kicking behind? I can make myself invisible, down to the waist. But what's the use of that when my legs remain exposed to view? My brain is a fairy brain, but from the waist downwards I'm a gibbering idiot. My upper half is immortal, but my lower half grows older every day, and someday or other must die of old age. What's to become of my upper half? And I've buried my lower half. I really don't know.
Poor fellow! I see your difficulty, but fairy brain, you should seek an intellectual sphere of action. Let me see. I've one or two boroughs at my disposal. Would you like to go into Parliament?
A fairy member? That would be delightful.
I'm afraid I should do no good there. You see, down to the waist, I'm a Tory of the most determined description. But my legs are a couple of confounded radicals, and upon a division, they'd be sure to lead me into the wrong lobby. You see, they're 2-1, which is a strong working majority.
Don't let that distress you. You shall be returned as a Liberal Democrat, and your legs shall be our peculiar care.
I see your Majesty does not do things by halves.
No, we are fairies down to the feet.
Fare thee well, attractive stranger.
Shouldst thou be in doubt,
today. Yes, we need to be married today.
My Phyllis, and today we are to be made happy forever.
Well, we're to be married.
It's the same thing.
I suppose it is. But oh, Streff, and I tremble at the step I am taking. I do believe that it is penal servitude for life for marrying a ward of court without the Lord Chancellor's consent. I shall be of age in 2 years. Couldn't you wait 2 years?
2 years? Have you ever looked in the glass?
No.
Here. Look at that, and tell me if you think it rational to expect me to wait 2 years.
Oh no, you are quite right. One must be reasonable.
Besides, why, you might fall in love with the Lord Chancellor himself by that time.
He is a clean old gentleman.
As it is, half the House of Lords are sighing at your feet.
The House of Lords are certainly extremely attentive.
Attentive? I should think they were. Why did 25 Liberal peers come down to shoot over your grass plot last autumn? Don't tell me it was the sparrows. And why did 25 Conservative peers come down to fish in your pond? Don't tell me it was the goldfish. No, no. Delays are dangerous. And if we are to marry, the sooner the better.
Thank you. blow the trumpets, bang the brasses.
Tries my temper for I'm such a susceptible chance for all.
It rather tries his temper for.
That you have appealed to me in a body to give her to whichever one of you she may think proper to select. And a noble lord has just gone to her cottage to request her immediate attendance. It would be idle to deny that I, myself, have the misfortune to be singularly attracted to this young person. My regard for her is rapidly undermining my constitution. 3 months ago, I was a stouter man. If I could reconcile it with my duty, I should unhesitatingly award her to myself. For I know of no one who is so well suited to render her exceptionally happy. Yes, but such an award would be open to misconstruction. Therefore, at whatever personal inconvenience, I waive my claim.
My lord, I desire on the part of this house to express sincere sympathy with your lordship's most painful position.
I thank your lordships. The feelings of a Lord Chancellor who is in love with a ward of court are not to be envied. What is his position? Can he give his own consent to his own marriage to his own ward? Can he marry his own ward without his own consent? And if he marry his own ward without his own consent, can he commit himself to contempt of his own court? And if he commit himself to contempt of his own court, can he appear by counsel before himself to move for arrest of his judgment? My lords, it is indeed painful to have to sit upon a woolsack which is stuffed with such thorns as these.
My lords, I have much pleasure in announcing that I have succeeded in inducing the young person to present herself at the bar of this heist. This house have diverged on every conceivable motion. All questions of party are merged in a frenzy of love and devotion. If you ask us distinctly to say what party we claim to belong to, we reply without doubt or delay, the party we're singing this song to. If you ask us distinctly to say, we reply without doubt or delay, the party we claim to belong to is the party we're singing this song to. The party we claim to belong to is the party we're singing this song to.
I'll stick to my pipes and my tables. I can spell all the words that I use, and my grammar's as good as my neighbor's. As for birth, I was born like the rest. My behavior is rustic but haughty, and I know what to turn for the best. And I want a particular party.
Ah, conversation is none of the best. I suppose she was born like the rest. She knows where to look for a party, when she wants a particular party. She knows
where to look
for a party,
whenever I want
for a party. For a party. She knows where to look for my party.
Born with love affected, nor treat with virtuous scorn the well-connected. High ranking follows no shame, we boast an equal claim, with him of humble name to be respected. Blue blood, blue blood, when virtuous love is sought, thy party is not. Though dated from the flood, blue blood, oh blue blood.
When virtuous love is sought, thy party is not. Though dated from the flood, blue blood, oh blue blood.
Spare us the bitter pain of stern denials, and with low-born disdain augment our trials. Hearts just as pure and fair may beat in Belgrave Square as in the lowly air of Seven Dials.
Blue blood, blue blood, of what avail or how to serve us now? Though dated from the flood, blue blood, oh blue blood, of what avail or how? Justify our definite command.
Tis I, young Strephon. Mind this priceless treasure. Against the world, I claim my darling's hand. A shepherd he, of Arcady, betrothed are we, and mean to be espoused today.
A shepherd he, of Arcady, betrothed are they, and mean to be espoused today. momentarily stagger. In each heart, proud are we innately. Let's depart, dignified and stately.
Let's depart, dignified and stately. Dignified and stately.
Dignified and stately.
Dignified and stately.
Dignified and stately.
Dignified and stately.
My lord, I know no courts of chancery. I go by nature's acts of parliament. The breeze, the bees, the seas, the rooks, the brooks, the gales, the vales, the fountains and the mountains cry, you love this maiden, take her, we command you. Tis written heaven by the bright barbed dart, which leaps forth into lurid light from each grim thundercloud. The very rain pours forth a sad and sodden sympathies. When chorus nature bids me take my love, shall I reply,
nay, but a certain chancellor forbids it.
Sir, you are England's Lord High Chancellor, but are you chancellor of birds and trees, king of the winds and prince of thunderclouds?
No, I don't know that I ever met it before. But you see, my difficulty is, there is no evidence before the court that chorus nature has interested herself in the matter.
No evidence? You have my word for it.
Okay, good sir. You mustn't tell us what she told you. It's not evidence. Now, an affidavit from a thunderstorm? Or a few words on earth from a heavy shower would meet with all the attention that they deserve.
And have you the heart to apply the prosaic rules of evidence to a case which bubbles over with poetical emotion?
Oh, distinctly. I have always kept my duty firmly before my eyes, and it is to that fact that I owe my advancement to my present distinguished position. Now listen to me. When I went to the bar as a very young man, said I to myself, said I, I'll work on a new and original plan, said I to myself, said I. I'll never assume that a rogue or a thief is a gentleman worthy implicit belief, because his attorney has sent me a brief, says I to myself, said I. Yes. Ah, yes. Ere I go into court, I will read my brief through, said I to myself, said I. And I'll never take work I'm unable to do, said I to myself, said I. My learned profession I'll never disgrace by taking a fee with a grin on my face when I haven't been there to attend to the case, said I to myself, said I. I'll never throw dust in a juryman's eye, said I to myself, said I. Or hoodwink a judge who is not overwise, said I to myself, said I. Or assume that the witness is summoned in court in expression of regret or of pleas or divorce, have perjured themselves as a matter of course, said I to myself, said I. In other professions in which men engage, said I to myself, said I. The army, the navy, the church,
and the stage,
said I to myself, said I. Professional license, if carried too far, your chance of promotion will certainly mar, and I fancy the rule might apply to the bar, said I to myself, said I. Thank you.
taken from you just as I was on the point of making you my own. Oh, it's too much. It's too much.
My son in tears and on his wedding day.
Oh, my wedding day. Mother, weep with me, for the law is interposed between us, and the Lord Chancellor has separated us forever.
The Lord Chancellor? Oh, if he did but know.
If he did but know what?
No matter. The Lord Chancellor has no power of you. Remember, you are half a fairy. You can refute him. Down to the waist.
Yes, but from the waist downwards, he can commit me to prison for years. Of what avail is it that my body is free, if my legs are working out several years penal servitude?
True. But take heart. Our queen has taken your special case to heart. I'll go to her and lay your peculiar case before her.
My own beloved mother, how could I repay the debt I owe you? To chase the gloom away on me I'd call.
What was that?
I think I heard him say that on a rainy day, to while the time away on her he'd call.
We think we heard him say that on a rainy day, to while the time away on her he'd call.
Collect yourself, I pray, and be careful what you say, as the ancient Roman said, festina lente. For I really do not see how so young a girl could be the mother of a man of 25.
My lord, of evidence I have no death. She is, has been, my mother from my birth. In babyhood, upon her lap I lay, with infant food she moistened my clay. Had she withheld that succor she supplied, by hunger quelled your strife and might have died.
Had that refreshment been denied? Indeed,
might have died.
Had a refreshment been denied, indeed our servants might have died.
But as she's not his mother, it appears, why weave these hot unnecessary tears? And by what laws should we so joyously rejoice because our Strephon did not die? Oh, rather let us wipe our eye, because our Strephon did not die.
That's very true, let's wipe our eye, because our Strephon did not die.
I don't believe it was his mother. Tarry diddle, tarry diddle, Tom Lonely! I have often had a use for a thoroughbred excuse of a son which is English for repenting. But of all I ever heard, this is much the most absurd, for she's 17 and he is 5'20".
She is 17 and he is only 5'20". Oh, my seven years ago.
For this paradox will be carried, nobody at all contradigente. The age upon the date of his birth was -8. If she's 17 and he is 5'20".
If she is 17 and he is only 5'20".
Go away, madam, I should say, madam, you display, madam, shocking taste. It is a rule, madam, to intrude, madam, with your brood, madam, brazen faced. You come here, madam, interfere, madam, with a peer, madam, I am one. You're aware, madam, what you dare, madam, so take care, madam, and be gone.
Never say, madam, I should say, madam, never say, madam, shocking taste. It is rude, madam, to allude, madam, to your brood, madam, brazen faced. With a peer, madam, any peer, madam, oh, my dear, madam, this is one.
She's a fairy from Anderson's library, and I took her for the proprietor of a lady's seminary.
We took her for the proprietor of a lady's seminary.
When next your houses do assemble, you may tremble.
Is tremendous.
They meet who underrate our calling, doom appalling.
Take down our sentence as we speak it, and he shall wreak it.
Oh, spare us.
Into Parliament, into Parliament, Parliament.
Parliament, into Parliament, 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 he shall go, into Parliament, he shall go.
In the parliamentary hall, Labour or Conservative, Leave, Remain, I don't know, but into Parliament you shall go.
Into Parliament he shall go, backed by their supreme authority, he'll command a large majority. Into Parliament, PA Parliament,
PA Parliament,
he shall go, into Parliament he shall go.
Into Parliament, into Parliament, 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 he shall go,
into Parliament he shall go.
Every bill and every measure that may gratify his pleasure, though your fury it arouses, shall be passed by both your houses. You shall suffer consequences if you submit false expenses.
No!
He shall stir up endless tussles with commissionaires in Brussels.
No, no!
All the counts in the ascendance, Welsh and Scottish independence.
Mercy!
If you continue to offend him, we'll have another referendum.
Yes!
Peers shall teem in Christendom, and a duke's exalted station be obtainable by competitive examination!
A high prestige.
The one prestige is French. The one prestige is French.
Your class we don't to sleep and go and die in there to fall on you. The last, the kind of that we do. The best, the bigger that we cannot say. What evils may result in consequence. Our lordly son you shall, the French we base can buy.
And what is French?
You seem to never before a herd of vulgar plants.
A Latin word.
To fill with joy and madness of the hoi polloi.
A Greek remark.
One Latin word, one Greek remark, and one that's French.
Your lordly son will quickly quench with base can buy.
That word is French.
You seem to never before a herd of vulgar plants.
A Latin word.
To fill with joy and madness.
A Greek remark.
A Latin word, one Greek remark, and one that's French.
Young strength, the less you find, and that we do. A bit, a big of that we cannot say. What evils may result in consequence. And though he said, the strength is you won't guide to all. The people who oppose our views and won't be just to offer us a place. We must be right, we must be right.
long a chap remains on sentry, go to chase monotony. He exercises of his brains, that is, assuming that he's got any. Though never nurtured in the lap of luxury, yet I admonish you, I am an intellectual chap, and thinks of things that would astonish you. I often think it's comical, fa-la-la, fa-la-la, and nature always does contrive, fa-la-la-la, that every boy and every girl that's born into this world alive is either a little liberal or else a little conservative. Fa-la-la, fa-la-la, is either a little liberal or else a little conservative. Fa-la-la. When in that house MPs divide, in labour, brain and cerebellum too, they've got to leave that brain outside and vote just as their leaders tell them to. But then the prospect of a lot of dull MPs in close proximity, all thinking for themselves, is what no man can face with equanimity. Then let's rejoice with loud fa-la, fa-la-la, fa-la-la, that nature always does contrive, fa-la-la-la, that every boy and every girl that's born into the world alive is either a little liberal or that's a little conservative. Fa-la-la, fa-la-la, is either a little liberal or else a little conservative. Fa-la-la.
Examination.
And he'll carry it too.
Carry it? Oh, of course he will. He's a parliamentary Eddie Stobart. He carries everything.
Yes, if you please.
That's our fault. Oh, the deuce it is.
We influence the members and compel them to vote just as he wishes them to.
It's our system. It shortens the debates and ensures a meaningful vote.
But think what it all means. I don't so much mind for myself. But a House of Peers with
No grandfather's worth mentioning. Well, the country must go to the dogs.
I don't wish to say a word against brains. I have a great deal of respect for brains. I often wish I had some myself. But with a House of Peers composed exclusively of persons of intellect, what is to become of the House of Commons?
I never thought of that.
This comes of women interfering in politics. It so happens that if there is an institution in Great Britain which is not susceptible of any improvement at all, it is the House of Peers. House of Peers made no pretense to intellectual eminence or scholarship sublime. Yet, written on her proudest mate in good Queen Mercer's glorious days. Yes, written on her proudest mate in good Queen Mercer's glorious days.
Yes,
Bonaparte, as every child can tell. The House of Peers throughout the war did nothing in particular and did it very well. Yet Britain sent the world ablaze in good King George's glorious days. Yes, Britain set the world ablaze in good King George's glorious days.
Yes, Britain set the world ablaze in good King George's glorious days.
And while the House of Peers withholds its legislative hand, and noble statesmen do not itch to interfere in matters which they do not understand. As bright will shine Great Britain's rays, as in victorious, glorious days, as bright will shine Great Britain's rays, as in victorious, glorious days.
As bright will shine Great Britain's rays,
as in victorious, glorious days.
Oh, lovely. Distinctly. For self-contained dignity combined with airy condescension, give me a British peer.
Then pray, stop this protégé of yours before it's too late. Think of the mischief you're doing.
But we can't stop him now.
Oh, charming, are they not?
Oh, why did you go into fierce fires, you great geese?
In vain to us you plead, don't go. Your prayers we do not heed, don't go. It's true we sigh, but don't suppose a tearful eye forgiveness shows. Oh no, we're very cross indeed, yes, very cross. Don't go.
It's true we sigh, but don't suppose a tearful eye forgiveness shows. Oh no, we're very cross indeed, yes, very cross. Don't go.
Don't go.
If that's the case, my dears,
don't go.
We'll go.
Shame upon you. Is this your fidelity to the laws you are bound to obey? Know ye not? It is death to marry a mortal.
Yes, but it is not death to wish to marry a mortal.
If it were, you'd have to execute us all.
Oh, this is weakness. Subdue it.
We know it's weakness, but the weakness is so strong.
We're not all as tough as you are.
Tough? Do you suppose I am insensible to manly beauty? Look at that man. A perfect picture. Who are you, sir?
Sergeant Willis, B Division, Metropolitan Police.
You're a very fine fellow, sir.
I am genuinely admired.
I quite understand. Now, here is a man whose physical attributes are simply godlike. That man has a most extraordinary effect upon me. If I was to submit to my natural inclination, I should fall down and worship that man. But I mortify the inclination. I wrestle with it, and it lies beneath my feet. That is how I treat my regard for that man.
Oh, foolish faith, think you because his brave array my bosom falls? I disobey our fairy laws because I fly in realms above in tendency to fall in love. Resemble I the amorous dove? Resemble I the amorous dove? Oh, amorous dove, time of Ovidius' nasal, this heart of mine is soft as thine, although I dare not say so.
Don't you think it's because I care for Stefan? For I hate him!
After all, no girl could care for a man who goes about with a mother considerably younger than himself.
Phyllis, my darling!
Oh, Phyllis, my own!
No! Don't! How dare you! Oh, but perhaps there are two noblemen I'm engaged to.
I am one of them.
I am the other.
Oh, then. My darling. My own. Well, have you decided which is to be?
Not altogether. It's a difficult position. It would be hardly delicate to toss up. On the whole, you are more you to the sun.
How could it possibly concern me? You're both earls. You're both rich. And you're both plain.
So we are. Oh, at least I am.
So am I.
Oh, no, no.
I am indeed very plain.
Well, well, perhaps you are.
See, there is really nothing to choose between you. If one of you would forgo his title and distribute his offshore estates to charity, why, I should then see reason for choosing the other.
Tolala, are you prepared to make this sacrifice?
No.
Not even to oblige a lady?
No, not even to oblige a lady.
Then the only question is, which of us should give way to the other? I suppose, on the whole, she may be happier with me. I don't know, I may be wrong.
No, I don't know that you are. But the awkward part of the thing is if you rob me of the girl of my heart, we must fight, and one of us must die.
Oh, dear.
It's a family tradition I've sworn to respect. It's a painful position, for I have a very strong regard for you, George.
My dear Thomas.
George, we were boys together. Well, at least I was. If I were to survive you, my existence would be hopelessly embittered.
Then, my dear Thomas, you must not do it. I say it again and again. If it will have this effect on you, then you must not do it.
No.
No, no,
no.
If one of us is to destroy the other, let it be me.
No, no, I cannot consent to an act which would crush you with unavailing remorse.
But it would not do so. I shall be very sad at first. Oh, who would not be? But it would wear off. I like you very much, but not quite as much as perhaps you like me.
George, you're a noble fellow, but a tempting, dearly crazy. No, you're very fond of me, George, and I cannot consent to give you a week's uneasiness on my account.
Oh, but, my dear Thomas, it would not last a week. Remember, you lead the House of Lords. On your demise, I shall take your place. Oh, my dear Thomas, it will not last a day.
Now, I do hope you're not going to fight him. After all, it's really not worthwhile.
Well, I don't believe it is.
Nor I.
Oh!
The sacred ties of friendship are paramount.
Though perhaps I may incur your blame, the things of you I would not do in friendship's name.
And I may say I feel the same. Not even love should rank above true friendship's name.
Then free me, pray me, mind the blame. Forget your craze and go your ways in friendship's name. In friendship's name.
Oh, many a man in friendship's name has yielded fortune, rank, and fame, but no one yet in a world so wide has yielded up to promise bright.
Accept, O friendship, all the same.
To thy dear name.
unrequited robs me of my rest. Love, hopeless love, my ardent soul encumbers. Love, nightmare-like, lies heavy on me chest and weaves itself into my midnight slumbers. When you're lying awake with a dismal headache and proposes to move my anxiety, I conceive you may use any language you choose to indulge in without impropriety. For your brain is on fire, the bedclothes conspire of usual slumber to plunder you. First your counterpane goes and uncovers your toes, and your sheet slips demurely from under you. Then the blanket tickles, you feel like Nick's pickles, so terribly sharp it's for pricking. And your heart and your cross and your tumble and toss till there's nothing twixt you and the ticking. Then the bedclothes all creep to the ground in a heap, and you pick them all up in a tangle. Next your pillow resigns and politely declines to remain at its usual angle. Will you get some repose in the form of a doze, with your eyes and head ever aching? But your slumbering teems with such horrible dreams that you'd very much better be waking. For you dream you are crossing the channel and tossing about in a steamer from Harwich, which is something between a large bathing machine and a very small second-class carriage. And you're giving a treat, penny ice and cold meat, to a party of friends and relations. They're a ravenous horde, and they all came on board and swims well as up Kensington stations. And bound on that journey you find your attorney, who started that morning from Devon. He's a bit on the side, and you don't feel surprised when he tells you he's only
11.
Well, you're driving like mad with this singular lad. By the ship's now a four-wheeler. At your playground games, and he calls you bad names when you tell him that ties pays the dealer. Well, this you can't stand, so you throw up your hand. You find you're as cold as an icicle. In your shirt and your socks, the black suit, no clocks, and Salisbury played on a bicycle. And he and the crew are on bicycles too, which they somehow or other invested in. And he's telling the tars all the particulars of a company he's interested in. It's a scheme of devices to get at low prices, all goods from confirmations to cables, which tickle the sailors by treating retailers as though they were all vegetables. You get a good statesman to plant a small tradesman, first take off his boots with a boot tree, and his toes will take root, and his fingers will shoot, and they'll blossom and bud like a fruit tree. From the greengrocer tree you get grapes and green pea, cauliflower, pineapple and cranberry, while the pastry cook plant cherry brandy will grant apple puffs and three-quarters and banberries. The shares are a penny, and ever so many are taken by Rothschilds and Baring, and just as if you are a lot of you awake with a shudder despair. Regular wreck with a crick in your neck, and no wonder you score, for your head's on the floor. You've needles and pins from your soul to your sheets. Your flesh is a creak, your left leg's a squeak. You're cramping your toes, a fly on your nose, a fluff in your lung, a feverish tongue, a thirst is intense in a general sense. You haven't been sleeping in clover. But the darkness is past, and it's daylight at last, and the night has been long. Ditto, ditto, my song. And thank goodness they're both of them.
Your lordship in this condition?
Ah, my lords, it is seldom that a Lord Chancellor has reason to envy the position of another, but I'm free to tell you that I'd far rather be two earls engaged to Phyllis than any other half dozen noblemen on the face of the globe.
Well, it's an enviable position when you're the only one.
Ah, yes, indeed, no doubt, most enviable. At the same time, seeing you thus, we naturally say to ourselves, this is very sad. His lordship is constitutionally as blithe as a bird. He trills upon the bench like a thing of song and gladness. His series of judgments in F-sharp minor, given on Dante in 6/8 time, are among the most remarkable effects ever produced within the court of Chancery. He is, perhaps, the only living instance of a judge whose decrees have received the honour of a double encore. How can we bring ourselves to do that which would deprive the Court of Chancery of one of its most attractive features?
I feel the force of your remarks. But I am here in two capacities, and they clash, my lords, they clash. I deeply grieve to say that in declining to accept my last application to myself, I presumed to address myself in terms which render it impossible for me ever to apply to myself again.
It was a most painful scene, my lords. Most painful. This is what it is like to have two capacities. Let us be thankful that we are persons of no capacity whatever.
Oh, come, come. Please remember that you are very just and kindly old gentlemen, and you needn't have any hesitation in approaching yourself, so that you do so respectfully and with a proper show of deference.
Oh, do you really think so?
I do.
Oh, very well. I will nerve myself to one last effort. If that fails, I resign myself to my fate.
If you go in, you're sure to win. Yours will be the charming lady. Be your lore, the ancient sore, faint, but never won fair lady.
Never, never, never faint, but never won fair lady. Every journey has an end, when at the worst affairs will end. Dark the dawn when day is nigh, hustle your horse and don't say die.
Shies at such a prize is not worth a mare evading. Be so kind to bear in mind, faint but never won fair lady.
Never, never, never faint but never won fair lady. While the sunshines make your hay, where a will is there's a way. Be as a lion in his lair, none but the brave deserve the fair.
I'll take heart and make a start, though I fear the prospect shame me. Much I've spent to gain my end, faint heart never won fair lady.
Never, never, never faint, was never won fair lady.
Nothing venture, nothing win, blood is thick, but horse is thin. In for a penny, in for a pound, it's love that makes the world go round.
Nothing venture, nothing win, blood is thick, but horse is thin. In for a penny, in for a pound, it's love that makes the world go
Damn it, it's too bad. I suppose one ought to enjoy oneself in Parliament, when one leads all the parties, as I do. But I'm miserable. Poor broken-hearted fool that I am. Oh, Phyllis. Phyllis!
Yes?
Phyllis? Phyllis! I suppose I should say, my lady. I've not yet been informed which title your ladyship has pleased to select.
I have not quite decided, for you see, I have no mother to advise me.
No, I have.
Yes, a very young one.
Not very, a couple of centuries or so.
Oh, she wears well.
She does, she's a fairy.
She's a what?
Oh, I've no longer any reason to conceal the fact. She's a fairy.
Well, that does account for a good many things. And that means you're a fairy too!
I'm half a fairy.
Which half?
The upper half down to the waistcoat.
Dear me, there's nothing to show for it.
Don't do that!
But why didn't you tell me?
Well, I thought you might take a dislike to me, but as it's all off, you may as well know the truth. I'm only half a mortal.
Oh, but I'd rather have half a mortal I do love than half a dozen I don't.
No, I think not. Go to your half dozen.
It's only two, and I hate them. Please forgive me.
I don't think I ought to. Besides, all sorts of difficulties would arise. You know, my grandmother looks almost as young as my mother, and so do all my aunts.
I quite understand. Whenever I see you kissing a very young lady, I shall know it's an elderly relative.
You will? Then, My Phyllis, I think we shall be very happy together.
We won't wait long.
No, we might change our minds. Mm. We'll get married first.
And change our minds afterwards.
That's the usual, of course.
If we're weak enough to tarry, ere we marry, you and I, of the feeling I inspire, you may tell you by and by. For pairs of flowing coffers, press their offers, that is why I am sure we will not tarry, ere we marry, you and I.
If we're weak enough to tarry, ere we marry, you and I, with the more attractive angel waiting you. If by chance we should be parted, broken hearted, I shall die. So I think we will not tarry, ere we marry, you and I.
Depend upon our obtaining his consent.
Oh, madam, you cannot refuse this. You know not what you ask. The Lord Chancellor is my husband.
Your husband?
My husband and your father.
Then our cause is plain. Upon his learning that Strephon is his son, all objections to our marriage will be at once removed.
No, he must not know. He believes me to have died childless, and dearly as I love him, I am bound under penalty of death not to undeceive him.
Victory!
But see, he comes. Quick, my veil.
Victory! Victory! Success is crowned by efforts, and I may regard myself as engaged to Phyllis. At first, I wouldn't hear of it. It was out of the question, but I took heart. I pointed out to myself that I was no stranger to myself, that in point of fact, I had been personally acquainted with myself for a number of years. And this had its effect. I admitted that I had watched my personal and professional advancement with considerable interest, and I handsomely added that I yielded to no one in admiration for my private and professional virtues. Oh, this was a great point gained. I then endeavoured to work upon my feelings. Oh, conceive my joy when I distinctly perceived a tear glistening in my own eye. Oh, after a severe struggle with myself, I reluctantly, most reluctantly, consented.
Oh my God.
may not be, for so the fate is signed. Learn thou that Phyllis is thy promised bride.
My bride! No, no.
It shall be so. Those who would separate us would betide.
My doom thy lips have spoken. I plead in
company, and yet the fairy law is clear. Every fairy who marries a mortal shall die.
Oh, allow me as an old equity draftsman to make a suggestion. The subtleties of the legal mind are equal to the opportunity. Oh, the thing is really quite simple. The insertion of a single word will do it. Let it stand that every fairy shall die who don't marry a mortal, and then you are out of your difficulty at once.
We like your humour. Very well. Sergeant Willis.
Yes, ma'am?
To save my life, it is necessary that I should marry at once. Oh, should you like to join the
Squad?
Well,
ma'am, I wouldn't think much of the British boy. You wouldn't inconvenience yourself to save a female in distress.
You're a very brave fellow. You're a fairy from this moment on. And you, my lords, how say you? Will you join our ranks?
Well, now the House appears to be recruited exclusively from persons of intellect, I really don't see what use we are down here. Do you, Talola?
None whatever.
Good. Then away we go to Fairyland.
Yeah.
my pleasures come in endless series. We will arrange happy exchange, House of Peers for House of Peers. Peeries, 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 House of Peers for House of Peeries. Up in the air, sky high, free from wars in chancery. I will be surely happier for, I'm such a susceptible chancellor. Up in the air.